Hello everyone, my name is Derek and today I'll be sharing about the Bangladesh project, which is part of my engineering honors capstone for the past 3 years. Hope all of you are at home and doing well. A little bit about myself, I'm a major in mechanical engineering and a minor in computer science. So my interests and hobbies, I love product development and just tinkering around. I love doing things like 3D printing, CADing, just love doing all these things. And I like talking to different people to explore different cultures, traveling as well, and I love playing the piano. A bit about the Honest Capstone summary. I'll be sharing about the partnership and needs assessment that was performed in Dhaka, Bangladesh. And I'll also be sharing about the cooling system prototyping and testing, which was performed this semester. There's this quote that I really like. It's by Dr. Prabjot Singh. He's the ex-director of systems design at the Earth Institute, which is in Columbia University. He says that we spend a lot of time designing the bridge, but not enough time thinking about the people who are crossing it. So what this really means is that a lot of times I feel like as engineers, we are very excited in solving technical problems, but it would be ideal if we focus about the people who are actually using it, which nicely ties in with something called socially engaged design. The design process that I have been using for the past 3 years, which has been really, really helpful. It's a process that has many like convergent and divergent thinking at different stages. It's a long process and it really involves stakeholders a lot. And it can be iterative, where multiple loops, but you eventually get there. Just talking a little bit more about team formation, going back all the way to fall 2017. See the picture on the right? It's Abrar, me, and then Tassin, Risa, Rumi, Nathan, Ben, just a few of us. And initially it's just me and Tassin. We got approved by Blue Lab, and then more people, like-minded people join us. These cool guys join us, and many other people join us as well. And that's how the team started. The mission for Blue Lab Bangladesh is to promote technological development in underprivileged areas of Bangladesh through multidisciplinary sustainable engineering solutions. For the partnership evaluation trip, it's actually when the first group of students from the team went to Bangladesh. So there's four of us, as you can see from the picture on the left, four of us who went, along with a instructor for the Center for Socially Engaged Design called Charlie Michaels. He's a really, really awesome guy that helped us a lot with choosing the most appropriate partner for our team. So basically what we did was we visited different NGOs and kind of talked to them, have meetings, have field visits, just to have a rough idea of how they operate. So firstly, for Spriha Foundation, they are focused on providing healthcare, education, and vocational skills to residents of the urban slums. And you can see on the picture on the left is kind of like a childcare program, and you're just like sitting in observing. And the picture on the right is one of our team members who are in one of the poorest regions of the urban slums. As you can see, these houses are made of tin sheets and they are erected on bamboo stilts. The next NGO organization that we visited was Friendship NGO. They mainly work with people living on river islands. They're called Achar people. And there are some initiatives that they have done surrounding healthcare, education, and disaster management. The picture on the left is an organizer who brought us onto one of the islands where we interacted with the locals. On the right is something really cool. It's basically like a ship where they built a mobile hospital in it so that they can move around and attend to the healthcare needs of the different people in different islands, which is really catered to their needs, which is cool. The last organization is the Environmental and Social Developmental Organization, ESDO. Picture on the left is them showing us about how food is being cooked in rural villages, and on the right is just in these rural villages how the living conditions are and how they have been supporting them. So it's a lot of emphasis on rural villages in Bangladesh. So what we did essentially was to form a partnership evaluation rubrics where we scored each organization based on a rigorous set of rubrics, and each rubrics have weights. So some criteria include positive perception between the NGO and the community. And also we wanted to gauge about how passionate they are about our potential as students to make a difference. Essentially, From the scoring process, we found out that Spreeha Foundation scored the highest of 284. And I guess there are clear reasons. For example, what stood out to us is that they're so passionate in youths coming up with ideas as to how to make differences in society. And because of that, because of their work culture, of how they value young people, we felt that it'll be very suitable for an organization like us from the University of Michigan, which is why we formed a partnership with them. And then in summer 2019, we went on the needs assessment trip. So for this trip, I personally didn't attend because I've already passed the team on to the next batch of leaders. So I helped them out a little bit with the interview protocol and some admin work that they have to do. They collected about a total of about 250 need statements, if I'm not wrong. And they figured that the top need statement, which is the need to provide greater thermal comfort to the Raya Bazaar urban slum residents living in Dhaka. We did a bit of research. Between March to August, the temperature fluctuates between 22 degrees Celsius to about 36 degrees Celsius, and a relative humidity between 55 to 80%, and really low wind speed, making it really uncomfortable to live in. A bit more contextual information. So houses were made from tin sheets or cement, and these houses were often rented from landlords, so they don't own them. 10 by 12 feet, they have few homes that have windows, and then cooling is required both day and night. In the day, because the sun is just, it's so hot during the day, and at night, it's because everyone's cramming in the apartment and their body generates a lot of heat. And the current solution is the use of a ceiling fan, but that is proved to be inadequate, as from what they were saying. A bit more contextual information. Slum residents, they share water access through tube wells, and gas is shared as well. And they experience approximately 2 hours of electrical disturbances per day, flooding up 40 centimeters. As you can see, these research are very important in helping us formulate user requirements and engineering specifications, which is supposed to guide how our product should be like. And just let me clarify something. So right now at this stage is basically when it's my last semester. So I proposed this project as part of my mechanical engineering capstone, and it was approved. So this effort is in concurrent to the Blue Lab's effort in developing a product as well. But so from the lab is me and then Betty, Rahul, Mihir, and Maddie. So all five of us, we're part of the ME450 team. And our efforts, just to clarify, is not part of the honors capstone. So the few of us, we interviewed those who traveled to Bangladesh from Blue Lab, as well as we did our own research, compared to read up a lot on standards, did our literature research, and we came up with 10 user requirements and engineering specifications, the top being safety and then affordability. So as for the target price, we were looking at a target price between 25 to 50, which is benchmarked to a ceiling fan that is present in almost all houses. As for adequate cooling ability, we used a framework that was developed by a research team in UC Berkeley. So there were three parameters mentioned before to describe thermal comfort, which is the temperature, the relative humidity, as well as the airspeed. So as you can see, the blue region, that is basically where if there's a point that lies in the blue region, people is basically experiencing thermal comfort. And we found that a temperature of 32 degrees Celsius with airspeed of 2.2 meters per second, that is that describes someone experiencing thermal comfort. And we also discovered that from some papers that people living in Bangladesh, in such a tropical region that is hot and humid, their body might be more conditioned to more intense conditions, which is why this region might be larger than what we see here. And other requirements, which I wouldn't really go through too much in depth, would be the compatibility with like tin and concrete house types. It must be easily operated, it must be easily installed, it must be durable, it must be reliable, it must be easily replaced or repaired, and very importantly, it must be sustainable. So for concept generation and selection, which is what we did as part of the ME450 curriculum. We explored ideas like evaporative cooling, basically moving air through a damp medium and get cooling from there, from the process of evaporation. We also looked at things like thermoelectric cooling, using electricity to generate a hot and a cold side on a chip. We thought about ideas like thermochimneys, as you can see from the top right, basically creating like a circulation, ventilation, and yeah, just different ideas that we explored. We both sketched as well as we did our own research. Oh, and also the reflective tarp, which can be placed on top of houses as well. So all of these possible ideas are categorized into different functions that we want to achieve, which is reducing temperature, reducing humidity, and increasing indoor airspeed. The conclusion is that we might need to combine some of these concepts to satisfy all the requirements. So we did a Pew chart just to see which solution scored the best with the requirements as a criteria. And we found out that thermoelectric cooling actually is the most promising idea, which is the idea that we will pursue. As for engineering analysis for the thermoelectric system, we were very, very privileged to have Professor Kabiani, who is really knowledgeable in heat transfer and has taught classes for many years in this topic. So we were referred to a few examples from his textbook, and we derived the governing equations, which are mainly the energy balance equation and the cooling power equation. So they can be applied to both the cold side and the hot side to get four equations. And with the four equations, we can solve for parameters that would give us ultimately this three output, which is the outlet air temperature on the cold side, the power input, as well as the coefficient of performance. So there's some typo error here. It should be power output over power input instead. So basically the amount of cooling power coming off the system per unit input into the Peltier system itself. So as a result of COVID-19, our ME450 team couldn't perform any prototyping or testing. So, and I have to go back home to Singapore, which is my home country. So that is why I brought along some sensors and tools just to carry on with prototyping and testing as part of the honors capstone requirement. So this is not part of ME450. As you can see, the picture on the right is a test setup, which I will explain more in the video later on. Hello everyone, this is the experimental setup for the Peltier cooling system prototype. And just a brief introduction, this is where the air is coming out from, this is where the air is going in, as well as heat being dissipated to the CPU cooler, which is the hot side, connected to the hot side of the module, whereas the cold side is connected to the cooling fin in which the air stream is passing through. As you can see, we hooked up thermocouples at different parts of the system to measure the essential temperatures for this experiment. We have T1, which is the outlet temperature, T2, which is the inlet temperature, as well as T3, which is connected to the hot side, sorry, the cold side, and T4 on the hot side. And the summary of temperature is as follows. This is after running about 3 minutes-ish. And we measured the inlet, the input current and voltage as well. And from there, we can get the input power into the system. Right, so with regards to the test results, we had a dead front configuration for one of the chip, which is the 12706 model. And if you can see from the test result, the graph on the left, the red curve represents the inlet power into the Peltier system, thermoelectric system, and then the blue color curve is basically the cooling power coming out of it. The dotted line being experimental, while the solid line being the model that is predicted. And error bars were being drawn from standard lab procedures, and we can see that the trend is generally the same. The same for the coefficient of performance on the right as well, which is quite promising. The only downside is that there is some discrepancies between the predicted value by the model as well as experimental data. And that discrepancy can be accounted for several reasons. For example, like the sensor errors, which is covered by the error bars. But not only that, for example, like the idea that this model assumes a constant base temperature, whereas the chip that we use is actually a chip that is covering only 4 by 4 centimeters. So as a result, there is less cooling power than what we would have expected. So we got similar results for the 127.10 chip. In fact, the trend is similar, but the error between the experimental and model is smaller, which is good. What's highlighted red, this circle, is an abnormality in the trend, which I think redoing the experiment would help a lot with. So to scale up, the MATLAB model has given us some information about how the prototype can be scaled up into a full-scale model that will provide us with enough airspeed, enough mass flow, enough temperature drop with the right amount of power input. And this is basically what this section will be addressing. We came up with different concepts. We sketched it out and tried drawing the dimensions. And then we CADded the entire model. And so if you can see from the picture on the right, it's basically an exploded view of the CAD, where in the middle you can see the thermoelectric chips. We were using 4 of them, and each of them is arranged in parallel to the 12-volt power supply. And you can imagine cold air coming this way and hot air going this way into the heat sinks, which is then where the heat is transferred to the air that's passing through, and then is blown out by the fan and then through the different couplers. So cold air on one side, hot air on one side, encapsulated by a casing with an electronic housing that basically keeps all the electronics into one nice compartment. So as you can see, there's some modularity there where there's this internal assembly, the different couplers, and the electronic housing and the casing, which is good as it makes the sub-assemblies very easily replaceable. And sustainable as well because most of these use aluminum and ABS plastic. And it's also important to note that the condenser collectors at the bottom, so that when moist air touches the travels through the cold fins, the condensate will be collected on the collector itself, which can be removed and then placed back in again. Cooling performance analysis, input power of 126 watts. Mass flow rate of 92 plus minus 10 CFM with a cooling and heating power of 154 to 276 watts respectively and a coefficient of performance of 122%. And comparing with the engineering specifications, we have achieved the specified target. We have a 3 degrees temperature drop with an airspeed of 2.2 meters per second. And a nice thing about this product is that it acts like a dehumidifier, where because of the condensation on the cold side, that's when there's a drop in relative humidity of the cold air stream coming on, which is cool. Bit on the cost analysis. So what we did was we have this spreadsheet of all the different parts, and we went on Alibaba to source the different materials. So for example, the heat sinks and the fans and the electronics, all of them could be bought wholesale in bulk. And for the casing and the couplers, we could potentially do injection molding. And it came out to a cost about $43.35. So that is within the total cost of which is our target cost, which is good. And of course, this cost can be driven down even more with negotiation, better market research, design optimization. And we also want to look at operational cost per month as well. So just from our research in Dhaka, 1 kilowatt hour is about $0.063. We calculated 12 hours of operation per day. That turns out to be about $2.77, which is 233 taka per month. And just to put things into perspective, we don't have a specified target for that, but that is basically the power consumption all the operational costs of a ceiling fan 1.5 times a fan. Yeah. So the illustration of a use case, imagine putting this thermoelectric cooler in the urban slum residence house, put it on the elevated platform with inlet air coming in from the top, and then this air is split based on what we've described from the diagram we showed. Hot air is rejected out of the house so that it's not recirculated back into the inlet, and cold air is directed at the person, which is supposed to provide thermal comfort. So next steps, we want to improve performance. We acknowledge that the real performance of this system is probably not as good as the MATLAB prediction, as from our test results that shows. And we can distill this into two biggest issues. The first issue is because we overestimated the cooling power of the product itself, from the reasons that we talked about earlier on from the test results. One thing we could do is to add 4 more thermoelectric elements. So that would drive costs up by maybe about $4. But essentially what we're doing is that we're spreading out the chips to cover a wider area. And when we cover a wider area, that would allow for a more uniform base temperature and therefore overcome the issue of the lower cooling power. And not only that, it's interesting that if these chips are operating at lower current, they have higher coefficient of performance, which is why we could potentially have like 2 in series per parallel branch, and we have 4 parallel branch, which makes 8 chips, and that would allow for the most optimal amount of cooling power. The second issue is overestimating air velocity. So acknowledging that air velocity drops because of pressure drop as air flows through the fin. And this can be overcome if we stack fans, because that increases pressure. I think it's important to benchmark this product with the existing products in the market. So just want to make a disclaimer that this is not a very extensive market research. But for example, the second product, the Walton BD, the BEAB168M, that product's actually what's recommended by Spreeher for us to look at. And we can see that, before we talk about the results, the other product is the EIC Solutions 400 BTU air conditioner. It's actually a product made in America. The previous Walton product is made in Bangladesh. So we could see that the Walton product has a superior fan speed because they use a bigger fan, but they essentially use the concept of evaporative cooling, which is introducing more moisture into the air that is cool. And because the air is already very humid in Bangladesh, I'm skeptical about how much cooling it can provide. As for the cost for the other thermoelectric coolers, it's really, really high. At around $800, so which makes our product worthwhile of consideration. Of course, that being said, there are other parameters to consider, like size, weight, or even the noise coming from the system itself. So the next steps is the fabrication of the finalized design that we have, and of course designing that will be some iteration. So it'll be ideal to have like the gathering of funds of about $1,000. Then it's important to develop a thorough validation plan. And then this product can be brought to Bangladesh for testing. And then the requirements can be validated with the users. So if this product is actually well received, we could iterate the design and check back with the users if that's what we want. In the long term, we can contact potential manufacturers and maybe even ensure that official standards are met. So really special thanks to Spreeha, especially CEO Tazin, Spreeha staff, community mobilizers, for just being so welcoming of us whenever we are over there once a year. And Center for Socially Engaged Design, Professor Skullers, who has helped us navigate through very tough partnership issues, especially at the formation stage of our team. So thank you. Charlie Michaels, who accompanied us through the entire process and giving us really good advice, and really appreciate your optimism and just cheerfulness, and IAs for guiding us with the curriculum that some of our members attended with CSET, Professor Kaviani for just being very patient and teaching us more about just more fundamentals of heat transfer. And Heather Cooper, who approved this project, for this project to have more progress, for the Honors Department for giving us some admin support and keeping us on track with our Capstone project. For Blue Lab and my ME450 friends, really appreciate all of you, because we wouldn't have achieved what progress we have if not for you guys. And yeah, it's really enjoyable working with you guys. And also for anyone else who believed in the project, who have been supporting, my family, especially my girlfriend, really appreciated that. And that concludes basically the presentation, but just want to draw back your attention to the quote, "We spent a lot of time designing the bridge, but not enough time thinking about the people who are crossing it." So if there's anything to take away, maybe this quote would suffice.